everyone's face this morning. And it's always good to be in the presence of God for this worship service. On a day like today when the sun is shining, and as soon as I say that, it's going to grow gray. But on a day like today when the sun is shining, it can seem maybe a little bit easier to sort of thank God, praise God for the sunshine that we don't get a whole lot of in this area of the country. But we're just grateful for what God has done for us this week, and that's why we're here, is to worship God with the song and praise. And I've been reading in the book of Job how Job was so afflicted for a time, and his friends were debating and telling him why he was going through this. And you know, through that he stumbled and he had some doubts, and you know, God ultimately set him straight and said, basically, I am God and you just have to trust me. And he did praise God throughout that. And so on a day like today when it's sunny, we can praise God. But even on the darker days, and on the days when we're not feeling so well, or we're just not feeling the Spirit so much, we still just need to push through and remember that God is good and God provides for all our needs, and he is faithful. So let us enter into our worship time.
Let's stand together at this time.
Wandering into the night, or wanting a place to hide this weary soul, in this bag of bones. And I tried with all my might, but I just can't win the fight. I'm slowly drifting, a vagabond. Just when I ran out the road, I met a man I didn't know, and he told me that I was not alone. He picked me up, he turned me around, he placed my feet on solid ground. I thank the Master, I thank the Savior. Deny what I've seen. There's no choice but to believe. My doubts are burning like ashes in the wind. So long to my old friends. The burden and bitterness just keep it moving. No, you are welcome here. From now till I walk streets of gold, I'll sing of how you saved my soul. This wayward son has found its way back home. He picked me up, he turned me around, he placed my feet on solid ground. I thank the Master, I thank the Savior.
Free. Small group, and we get together and we talk about different things in our lives. We talk about what we're going through and what God's doing in our lives. And it was a little heavy this week, and there were several things that people were talking about. And this word overwhelmed kept being used, you know, overwhelmed by schoolwork, overwhelmed by stress at work, and all those different things. And when you normally use that word overwhelmed, it has a lot of negative connotations. I think of like my brother pushing me into the pool when I was little and that water just being overwhelming and it's on you on every side. And it's not normally a good feeling. And it was funny when we got here today, this next song that we're going to sing is called Overwhelmed. And when I was singing this morning, it really brought a different reality to it of being overwhelmed by God's love, by God's presence, by his faithfulness. And it just really challenged me to see that word in a different way. So if you're here this morning and you've come in overwhelmed by the world, that's fine, because when we came through those doors, we left the world out there and we are now in the presence of the Lord. And so as we sing this, I just pray that he would speak to you and he would encourage you this morning.
I see the works of your hands, the galaxies spinning a heavenly dance. Oh God, all that you are is so overwhelming. I hear the sound of your voice. All at once it's a gentle and thundering noise. Oh God, all that you are is so overwhelming. I delight myself in you, captivated by your beauty. I'm overwhelmed, I'm overwhelmed. God, I run into your arms, unashamed because of mercy. I'm overwhelmed, I'm overwhelmed by you. I know the power of your cross, forgiven and free forever. You'll be my God, and all that you've done is so overwhelming. 'Cause I delight myself in you, in the glory of your presence. I'm overwhelmed. Beautiful, oh God, there is no one more beautiful. You are beautiful, God, you are the most beautiful. You are glorious, you are glorious, oh God. You are glorious, I've tried so hard to see it. It took me so long to believe it. You choose someone like me to carry your victory. Perfection could never earn it. You give what we don't deserve it. You take the broken things and raise them to glory. 'Cause you are my champion. Giants falling, you stand undefeated. Every battle you've won, I am who you say.
Stop.
you are my champion. Giants fall when you stand undefeated. Every battle you won, I am who you say I am. You crown me with confidence. I'm seated in the heavenly place, undefeated with the one who has conquered it all.
Good morning. When I was getting ready this morning, I was listening to this this talk show radio program, and there was someone being interviewed talking about really the five most critical things that are going on in the world right now, starting at the top and working its way down. And I know that there's some people that are of the mindset that if they can't do anything about the news, then why listen to it? But I'm kind of a different mindset, because God, Jesus, it said in the song, has given us the authority. And when we do open up our mouth, the walls come crashing down, right? That gentleman that was talking on the radio today gave me five really important things to be praying for in this world right now. And so God has put us on this earth to use us for his purpose, to use us for his victory. And he calls us to come before him and pray for the things that are going on with each other, going on in our church, but also what's going on in our world as well. You know, God's not a random God. He's in charge of all this, and he's the one that's going to cure all these things that are going on. And so I just ask you this morning to come before him with me, God, or you all. Come before God, and let's just put the issues of our own personal life, the issues of our church, and the issues of our world before the one who's in charge of all of it. Lord God, you are so crystal clear on what's going on in this world, and sometimes, a lot of times, especially right now, we don't have an understanding of anything, God. And every day, it seems like something new pops up that just seems so obscure and so bizarre. But you are in charge of all this, Lord. And like the song says, every time we open up our mouth, God, walls come crashing down. And we pray for the victory today. We pray, God, that you will have victory over all that is against you, God. And I just pray for this congregation this morning, God. I just pray for things that people have brought in this morning with them, Lord. Things that are going on in their own lives, the unspoken things that we don't even need to know what they are, but you know what they are, God. So I just pray your hand on all of them, for every person here and every family, God, that they represent. All their cares, all their troubles, God, I put before you this morning, God. I pray also, Lord, that what we have for you this morning, our worship, our time, our finances, all of that, God, that would be pleasing to you. And I ask all this in Jesus' most holy name. Amen.
Passage of scripture we'll look at today is found in Luke chapter 19, if you'd like to turn your Bibles there. Jesus was entering Jericho, and Jericho is just 15 miles from Jerusalem. And knowing that next week is Palm Sunday, he comes into Jericho, and he's now, I was just interested in what was happening in this week before we get to Palm Sunday, and that's where this message comes from. The parable that Jesus speaks is spoken before entering Jerusalem. We're going to look at that parable today. I was interested in what Jesus was speaking about as he's heading towards Jerusalem. If Jesus knew he was going to be crucified in just a few days from this point on, what did he want the people to know? In other words, what was the last thrust of his message and all that? What is his closing statement before he gets to Jerusalem and speaks to the people in Jerusalem? But what does he to say to the people in Jericho and along the road there? In the first 10 verses of chapter 19, it's the story of Zacchaeus. And we looked at that not long ago. And Jesus calls Zacchaeus into a relationship with himself. He says these words, look, come down from the tree and then we're going to go to your house. We're gonna break bread together and we're going to have a relationship. And when that happened and he comes down from the tree and he's walking with Jesus and some of his friends are there, the crowds have a problem with Zacchaeus, right? They look at him and they see, in what they say is that Zacchaeus is basically a sinner, that Zacchaeus hasn't lived a life that other Jewish people think is the way he should live. And in a sense, if you look down through those 10 verses, you're going to see that Zacchaeus was moved at this accusation. He was moved by Jesus' wanting to be in relationship with him, wanting to go to his house for dinner. And he made a public statement to the people there and to Jesus. And he turned to Jesus in verse 8 and he declared to him and to those that could hear that he would give half of his goods or finances to the poor. And if there was any cheating that had happened between him and anyone in that community, that he would pay it back four times the amount to that person. And Jesus received Zacchaeus' declaration of repentance. And he says in these words, he declares, salvation has come to Zacchaeus and to his house. And so Jesus, for Zacchaeus, has now become like Abraham and has lived by faith. And doing what he was supposed to do, it took an act of faith, and he stands in front of the public and he declares this. And now he was not only a son of Abraham, because he was a Jewish man, and so he was a son of Abraham by lineage, but by now he was also a son of Abraham in the sense by spirit, because now he is walking in faith with Jesus. And so there's this, in these 10 verses, there's this encounter that happens with Zacchaeus, and Jesus ends it in verse 10 with this statement. For the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost. So this entire encounter with Zacchaeus could be summed up with this sentence. That Jesus' thrust on why he came to earth was to seek and to save the lost. And Zacchaeus was a perfect example of this. And in the sense, Zacchaeus was one that answered this call and decided that he was, in the sense, needing to be saved and needing to change his life. So he was sought after and he was saved that particular day. So when we get to verse 11, and that's really where I want to land today, let's read that together. While they were listening to this, meaning the verses, the conversation that Jesus is having with Zacchaeus, while they're listening to this, he went on to tell them a parable because he was near Jerusalem and the people thought that the kingdom of God was going to appear at once. He said, a man of noble birth went to a distant country to have himself appointed king and then to return. So he called 10 of his servants and he gave them 10 minas, or 10 pounds. And he said, put the money to work, he said, until I come back. But his subjects hated him and they sent a delegation after him to say, we don't want this man to be our king. He was made king, however, and he did return home. Then he sent for the servants to whom he had given the money and ordered to find out what they had gained with it. The first one came and said, sir, your mina has earned 10 more. Verse 17, well done, my good and faithful servant. His master replied, because you have been trustworthy in a very small matter, take charge of 10 cities. The second came and said, sir, your mina has earned 5 more. And the master answered, you take charge of 5 cities. Then another servant came to him and said, sir, here is your mina. I have kept it and laid it away in a piece of cloth. I was afraid of you because you are a hard man. You take out what you did not put in and reap what you did not sow. His master replied, I will judge you by your own words, you wicked servant. You knew, did you, that I am a hard man, taking out what I did not put in and reaping what I did not sow. Why then didn't you put the money on deposit so that when I came back, I could have collected it with interest? Then he said to those standing by, take his mina away from him and give it to the other one who has 10. Sir, they said, he already has 10. He replied, I tell you that to anyone who has, more will be given, but for those who has nothing, even what he has will be taken away. But those enemies of mine who did not want me to be king over them, bring them here and kill them in front of me. In verse 11, as they were listening, all of the people who are listening would be described in this way and would include these people. As we might remember, Jericho was in the sense, like almost like a recreation area for those that were serving in Jerusalem in the temple area. So there was a lot of movement between that road into Jerusalem. And so in Jericho would be the Pharisees, would of course be the Sadducees, there'd be priests, there'd be Levites, and of course there would be the crowd. And so when they were all listening, we have to understand who was in this crowd. And so it's Jewish people, it's people that are actually working in the temple and all that. And so when Jesus uses this parable, he adds to what they have already heard that's happening to Lazarus. And my question is, why? Why does Jesus have to add to this conversation? But it's given to us right there in verse 11. It says, look, he said these things. He added to his conversation for two reasons. Number one is that they were near Jerusalem. And so I thought about this. Well, we know as we're thinking about Palm Sunday, we're thinking about Easter, we're going to celebrate all that. But what's important about Jerusalem at this time? And you got to remember, they were heading up for the Passover. The Passover would be that next week happening. And so he, in a sense, wants to speak to this idea of the Passover. He wants to speak to the idea of the people that are lost, which would be everybody from his perspective in Jerusalem. Now, if you look, and I didn't grab the passage earlier, but you'll see one of the Gospels says, as Jesus got to Jerusalem, before he enters Jerusalem, he sees Jerusalem, and what does he do? He starts weeping and says, if they only knew, right? If they only knew who I was and only knew what to do, they could have life. And so Jesus, number one, adds to this for that reason. And number two, we see people thought that the kingdom was going to appear at once. So there was a correction that Jesus had to make in this story. And really, it moves a lot to the number two statement. The reason why is the people thought, the disciples thought that something different was going to happen than what Jesus did. No one expected Jesus to be crucified, even though he explained it to them three times before we get to this particular spot in Luke. He's already told them three times, but it's in some way it's just continued to go over their head. And Luke even says, look, they just don't understand when Jesus tells them that he's going to die. They just don't understand it. And so we have these two reasons in which Jesus adds these words to the conversation with Zacchaeus and what happens. The idea of seeking and saving the lost, he's adding these words too. So in verse 12, we learn that Jesus is identifying himself as the noble or the prince. Jesus is the one who is going to be crowned king. Jesus is going to leave that for a time to become king, and he's coming back. He's going to a distant country there, and we can say he's going to heaven to be appointed king, and we know he's going to be appointed king by God, and he is the King of Kings, and all, and we see that language elsewhere in the Bible, but he is going to have a return. And so next we learn that 10 of his servants are called in. Okay? So you can just think of it. He goes to the servants and says, this is what's going to happen. I am leaving for this reason. I'm going out, but there's some responsibilities to each one of you, and this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to give you 10 minas or 10 pounds or in another place, talents. In the bottom line, as a servant of mine, you know that there's an expectation to put it to work until he comes back. This idea to put it to work means the idea of keeping busy with it, right? It's not just an idea of like taking the money down and getting lucky with it and doubling the money and saying, I did it. I can now take this money and set it. And when the master comes back, I can say, here you are. I doubled the money. It's not that idea. It's this idea of the king saying, look, I'm giving you this responsibility. And while I am gone, you're in care of, taking care of all of this stuff that I normally take care of, you are now the steward of it. So it's not just a doubling or a tripling or that. It's the idea of keeping busy with the idea of what Jesus was trying to do for men. Next, in verse 14, we learn that the subjects, now they're different than the servants, right? Jesus calls in the nobleman calls in the 10 servants, and they're before him, and he gives them a thing. But next, they use the word subjects. And they are not servants, but they're citizens. And they do not want him to be king. So they send a delegation. And I thought about that from the idea which we'll learn from Palm Sunday into Easter, that whole week. You know, there is this, Jesus is before Pilate, and Jesus is before Herod, and Jesus is before, and there is this delegation that goes and says to Pilate, look, we don't want this guy. He's not our king. Matter of fact, we'll take the robber guy over him. And so there's a delegation sent that pleads. But one thing we do know, nothing man could do could stop Jesus from doing and being what God has brought him here to do. Even though a delegation was sent out, even though the Jews seem to have the upper hand, even though they bring him to the cross, even though it still doesn't stop the idea of seeking and saving the lost. So he reminds us, the nobleman reminds us, look, he's going to be made king anyways, and he was made king. In verse 15, the king returns home, and he calls the servants in to see how they kept themselves busy with their task. What were your gains? What did you do and all that? And so we saw the first servant comes in. He says, look. And I just want to look at the language of how he speaks to the master in this way. He says, sir, obviously the idea of respect, sir. And then he uses the word your talent, your mina, your pounds, your money has earned you. Okay? It's very interesting. Because lots of times I think it would be like this. Okay, boss, you gave me this and I took it. And I went over here, and I did this, and I did this, and I did this, and here you go. Okay? But the first servant has this idea of, look, this is yours. It always was yours. I have responsibility here, but what my responsibility isn't really of me. It's of what you put me in charge of, and I was just faithful to that. And so now here's yours giving back to you. And so the exchange is well done. You're trustworthy. Right, you're faithful in small matters, and this idea of do this. Now, what a huge jump. Take charge of 10 cities. And can you imagine that? I almost step back and say, whoa, 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 wait a minute. I'll take the few pounds or the few talents, a few things, and I'll work those for you, God. But do you have to continue to give me more and more responsibility? Be honest, how many Christians feel that way? Do I truly want more responsibility because I've done a good job with other things? In a way, I think we want to do this. We say, Lord, thank you for helping me be trustworthy. Thank you for helping me do all this. But can I go out to pasture now for a few minutes? Right? Can I go on a vacation? Can I leave those, the people that I've been helping? Can I just get away and all that kind of thing? I was just surprised when he got 10 more cities because now I know what that means, 10 more problems. 10 more, a lot of problems. But it doesn't seem to me that the servant objects to it. It's almost like the servant gets it. In verse 20, looking at the contrast, we will leave the man in the middle alone today. And in the contrast, one servant came in and said, here is your mina, not lost. But not worked. There was no advantage or increase unto his master. There was ownership in the language. You'll see it there. There's ownership and acknowledgement of his, like it's his money. There's that. But the service requested of him was neglected. Yes, I know it's yours. Here it is. But what I'm pushing back is the service requirement of me to do something with it, okay? And he gives the excuses, and the servant continued to give excuses for his not working or expanding of what was given to him. He says, look, I'm fearful to the master's, you know, will. I don't, what he's asking is I'm fearful of, and instead of his will, fearful of being his servant, I'm going to be my own servant. I'm going to be respectful of God's stuff. I'm going to be respectful of maybe even God's church. I'm going to be respectful of who God is, and I'm not. But you know what? As far as moving into a servant position with God, that's where things change a little bit. I see you, God. This is him. I see you, God, is hard to please, master. Matter of fact, I think at times you're even cruel. And you're certainly not compassionate. And so think about this is how he feels about what God is asking of him as a servant. I see that you reap without sowing. I see that you take and it's not yours. Notice a little bit of a shift there. This servant doesn't see God as owner of everything. He certainly doesn't see God as ownership of his own life, and he certainly doesn't see God as having the ability to take what is created and to use it in any way that he sees fit. Now, we have to realize that Jesus has no concern for money or accumulation of wealth, right? We know that. That's not why Jesus came. We can see that he didn't buy a house. He didn't do any of that kind of thing when he was here. So we must understand this parable is speaking to the Zacchaeus story, okay? It's not speaking to whether or not, you know, hey, I gave you this and now I'm expecting you to make me wealthy and all that. That's not what's happening here. Jesus is speaking or adding to what happened to Zacchaeus. Jesus is speaking to what the people around him saw happening to Zacchaeus. Jesus is speaking to Zacchaeus' proclamation to the people. I'm going to give half of what I have now to the poor, right now. And I'm going to make right anything that I've done wrong. So Jesus is adding to this. Zacchaeus is a servant who understood his calling from Jesus in an instant. In that moment when Jesus called him, and after people started saying things, he saw his life for what it was, and he made an instant correction, and he made it before God, and he made it before man, and said, this is my intention. And the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the rabbis and the priests and the Levites and all the other servants are all called in to explain their lack of performance as a servant. I'll back up a little bit. Let's just look at it again. Jesus walks and sees this man in a tree and says, Zacchaeus, come down from here. See, he knew his name before there was any introduction. He says, I want to have a relationship with you. Let's go to your house and let's have dinner. And along the way, his mind is opened up to who he truly is. And it took the people around it, maybe, to speak the truth to him and say, hey, this is how we see you. But it also took the love of Jesus wanting to have a relationship and for him to come to this thing. And so he makes a change, but Jesus is speaking to those that haven't made a change. And it's interesting, at Jericho to Jerusalem, those 15 miles, there's this incredible parable that happens somewhere in the midst of those two cities. And you guys know it as the parable of the Samaritan. And really, that is another conversation that Jesus is trying to push into the Pharisees, the Sadducees, the Levite, the priests, and everybody, and all the servants and people that know of him, and he's pushing them into this. And he says, look, I'm not talking about money here. I'm not talking about your talents here. I'm talking about whether or not you're getting this concept. Are you a good servant or are you a bad servant? And the parable of the Samaritan showed where their servanthood was. As they walked by the person that needed to be served, the three of the most important people in the Jewish community walk by and say, we will not serve him in this way. And so Jesus is adding to Zacchaeus' story, trying to wake them up, trying to get them to see. In verse 27, and Jesus finishes his words, and his attention turns to the citizens of the kingdom. And Jesus is strong here, and he uses the words, my enemies, who don't want me to be king. And I think of it this, you know, after Palm Sunday, in that middle of that week, and these trials are happening, and they're shouting, crucify, 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 and they're doing all these things, and there's just, they do not want Jesus to be their king in the way that Jesus wants to be their king. And so Jesus speaks to them in verse 27, the ones who reject me, the ones who have a decision that they can choose me as king or not choose me a king, but they choose not to serve me. And he basically says, look, your lives will be lost. I mean, strong language there. Bring them in front of me and so that they can be killed in front of me. Your lives will be lost or your lives will be taken from you. And so I think, in a way, you could look at that this short thing and just say, you know what? If we're not going to come under the servanthood of God, and if we're not going to come under the idea of him being God and us being less than him, then we already are forfeiting life from the very time we say no to his being king. And simply put, life without Christ is temporary. Life without Christ is void of abundance. It's lacking of peace. It's lacking of hope. It's lacking of love. And yes, there can be moments that people seem to have their life all together without Christ. But when he comes right down to it, you're going to see in their life this incredible lack of abundance. There's an incredible death of the spirit without God in our lives. And there's void of any true purpose that is lasting other than what we can build and see things destroyed and teared down. There's nothing to be handed down from generation to generation. And then I thought to myself, man, it was just 40 years from that point that Jerusalem was destroyed. And it wasn't just taken over by the Romans. The Romans already occupied it. It was literally torn apart. Every stone was ripped down and it was destroyed. And so were the people in there. Not only the people, but their children. And I don't think God truly wanted to destroy Jerusalem. But it wasn't no longer the Jerusalem that God intended it to be. And so for God to let Jerusalem be destroyed in 70 AD by the Romans, I don't think it, in the sense, was this grieving thing. It was just like, this is no longer what the temple meant or what it really was. So it's not destroying me at God because I'm no longer God of that. And so it lets it happen. Because what was based upon the temple and all that was no longer about Jesus. It was no longer about God, but it was about a religion that was void of the Spirit of God. I'll say it again. When Jesus came, their religion was void of the Spirit of God. It had a ton of rules, but it had no ability to help those that needed help. It had no ability to serve a God who had intentions and purpose. These were the last words of Christ before his entry into Jerusalem. The last words before we, in a sense, get to Palm Sunday next week. I think they're sobering. I think in some way you could say even the idea of him having the people in front of him killed is shocking to us. Yet Jesus wanted them all to hear these truths. Jesus didn't proclaim this in a room closed with just a few people, but he spoke it to the open, to the people, and to a place where it would spread quickly. You have been created by God today with an expectation of respecting the Creator. I'll say it again. All of us has been created by God with an expectation that as his creation, we look to him with incredible respect. And in the Old Testament, we'd use the word fear in a good way. In other words, a holy fear of who he is. We were created that way. The seeking of the lost is God sending his son to find his creation. And so here we were created to have a respect and to love God and all that kind of thing. But when Jesus came, this was void all around him. And so it was like Jesus was trying to gather up everybody and say, look, look, this is the way to God. Come this way, come this way. And here we are today with the same thing that's happening. There's tons of us that are lost. And there's a God who is seeking and sending his son for us to be found. And the saving of the lost, the saving of his creation, accepting his salvation, and the salvation is understood in the changing of one's will to become a servant to the king. And Zacchaeus got it and responded to Jesus' call in a really powerful way. And for many others coming to terms with a God who would ask of them to work his kingdom, it was too much of an ask for them. They said, we want no king. We want, have no expectation of a responsibility of his kingdom put on us. And so here we are in some ways divided, I guess. And I think we have a question that needs to be answered for each one of ourselves today. First of all, am I a servant of God? Am I a servant of God? Do I accept the call to work and to expand his kingdom? I think there's lots of times we say, yeah, God, you know, I'm glad that you love me. I'm glad that you died for me. I'm glad that you want to bless me. I'm glad that you have what's my best interest in mind and all that stuff. And bring it on. Pour it into my lap, you know. But then we struggle with this thing of responsibility back. Well, he says, look, I'm going to be gone for a little bit. I'm going to be away. And so now I'm going to give you some of the expectations of what I'm doing for the other people around you. And so will you help me expand my kingdom with my love and with my grace, with my miracles, with my power? Will you be a part of that? We have another question we need to answer for ourselves today. Do I see God as something he's not for some of us? Some of us see God as too demanding. That we're like in some way waiting for God to say, all right, that's it. I want you to go there. And we're going to say, you know what? I'm not going there. And in our lives, there's all these decisions. And we think to God, God, why would you do this to me? Why would you put this on me? You know, why don't you do it another way? Why do you have to use me to speak to them or to help them or to bring compassion to them? Why does it have to be me? And so some of us today, we not only struggle with the idea of being God's servant, but we struggle with it being too demanding on us, of our finances, of our time. Next question is, look, I'm a citizen of the earth. I'm here. I recognize I'm alive. I recognize that you're here too, and I realize that, and I'm a citizen of the earth. But some of us don't want a king, and we don't want a king of our kingdom. So my question is this: who then do you serve, and what is your purpose for the serving if it isn't for him? Remember, these are the words of Jesus before he goes into Jerusalem. He's speaking to his disciples. He's speaking to the citizens of that area. And he's speaking to all of us that have come after. Are you a servant, Zacchaeus? You're one of Abraham's sons. Are you a servant who has lost your purpose? And in that day, Zacchaeus thought himself and says, yeah, I guess I truly am. Because I've taken this job of being a tax collector. I'm working for Rome for my benefit to line my pockets so that I can have a better life, so that my family could be richer. And I lost your purpose to see the least among me as my responsibility. Are you a citizen who doesn't want a king? Zacchaeus looked at his life and realized he was wrong. And that's why Jesus came to seek and save the lost. That's how Jesus finishes up. Man, Zacchaeus realized who he was, and that's why I came. And it's almost like Jesus says, story finished, and leaves it alone. But then we fall into this, most of us probably said today, you know what, I realize that I want to be a servant. But there's two types of servants. There's the servant at work, and there's the servant at rest. I hope many of us wouldn't say today, I'm a citizen in denial. I don't think that's what we're going to stand up and say. I don't think many of us are going to stand up and say, you know what, I'm going to not deny God is God. I'm going to deny him having, you know, power over everything. I'm not going to do that. But I think I'm struggling with this idea of whether or not I should be at work or whether or not I should be at rest. But Jesus came to seek and save those of us who have a misunderstanding of what it means to be a servant of God. So I'm just going to leave you with that in a way. And let God speak to you on that behalf. Are you a servant at work, or are you a servant at rest? Our Heavenly Father, we're thankful for who you are. We're even thankful for the blessings in life. Thank you for the love that you've shown to us through sending your Son here to forgive us and to give us the possibility of an abundant life and an eternal life. But Lord, at sometimes we get caught up in forgetting who the servant is and who the master is. And Lord, sometimes we get caught up and messed up in what our whole purpose is. And I think sometimes, Lord, we even forget that you've entrusted us with something. And Lord, as you've been gone in the sense away and we're waiting for your return, and Lord, that we've kind of got onto our own thing and build our own houses and build our own lives and all that. And Lord, I just think that at times we need to be reminded, as Zacchaeus was, that you've come to seek and to save us because of our misconception of what we should be doing and who we are. So Lord, I just pray today, Lord, that you would just continue to speak to us. And Lord, help us to see clearly who we are before you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let's stand together.
Lord, I come, I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. Without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. 'Cause Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Yeah. Hour I need you, my one defense, my righteousness, oh God, how I need you. Where sin runs deep, your grace is more. Where grace is found is where you are. And where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. Lord, I need. My song to rise to you When temptation comes my way, when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. So teach my song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, and when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. Cause Lord,
may our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God our Father, who loved us and by his grace gave us eternal encouragement and good hope, may he encourage your hearts and strengthen you for every good deed and word that you say. Amen.
No, I did not. Not during.
Not that.
No.
What's up, SJ?